This is Top Landing Gear. Hello and welcome to Top Landing Gear and a completely brand spanking new episode. In the previous episode, we cast a fond look back at some of our favourite interviews from the first three series. But now we've actually bothered to pick a new subject, and a highly relevant one at that. 2022 marks the 40th anniversary of the Falklands War. So we're devoting a couple of episodes to some of the most remarkable stories to have come out of that conflict. In Series 2, we covered the Harrier and Sea Harrier operations in the Falklands with the author of Harrier 809, Roland White. In this episode, we're focusing on what has arguably become the most famous mission of all during the Falklands, certainly from an aviation point of view, the Black Buck raids. In particular, Black Buck 1, flown by our very special guest aboard Vulcan XM607, Martin Withers. We'll introduce Martin a little later, but first of all, I'd like to introduce the Top Landing Gear team. Someone who knows all about Withers, certainly in a horsey sense. Our historian and quick facts compiler, but more pertinently, equestrian fencer. Do you see? My brother, Jez Curling.
Hello, everyone.
Wow.
Hello,
Jez. Hasn't got better.
It's got worse.
Series 4.
Oh, it's really? Okay.
Probably time to move.
Horses makes me think of stables. And a more stable person you couldn't wish to meet, a really solid member of the team who knows everything there is to know about aviation and without whom this podcast would be even more pointless than it already is. Former RAF pilot, now with the airlines, it's our very dear and valued friend, James Carter.
Good afternoon, evening. Good evening. Hello, wherever you are.
That was a nice intro.
That was the best one, yeah. Yeah.
I thought you were going to say Royce Dry.
No. What's coming?
Well, Jez and James may not be much to look at, but we do have a bit of showbiz glamour amongst the four of us. We'll come on to me in a moment.
But first,
let's hear it for indie pop legend, singer-songwriter with a band Scouting for Girls, and Microlite student pilot Roy Stride.
Hello, hello. It's like a best man speech.
Given
by one of your really good friends, so you're really willing it to be good.
And over.
It is funny, and over.
Finally, continually managing to avoid the temptations of Botox and collagen, and yet still looking $1 million.
But you'll drink anything, wouldn't you?
I will, yeah. Former star of the silver screen, silver-haired, silver-tongued, and metal-kneed, me, Rob Curley.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
It's lovely to be together again.
Isn't it great?
Yeah.
I like that.
How's everybody?
Very good.
Good. Been busy?
Yeah, not bad.
Been flying, Roy?
No, but I've got my instructor finally sent him a message when I got back from LA going, I'm ready to go. And he goes, I'm getting married and going on honeymoon. So 2 weeks' time, I should be flying.
Great.
Yeah. Amazing.
Great. Yeah. In the old Icarus. And Jimbo, doing much?
Yeah, well, my sort of flying roster's back up to almost pre-pandemic levels, which is good. And all the flights are full.
I've heard that from people who've been flying. Yeah. Flights are much fuller than they would be normally because there are still fewer flights, but more people about flying.
A bit fewer, but also people have been waiting so long to fly that now things are open much more than they were on the last holiday we had.
Yeah,
it seems to have gone crazy in the last few weeks.
Good. So, good in many ways.
Good in many ways.
Yeah.
I've also been sitting on a digger, telling you I was Jez.
Oh, really?
Building an extension in the house.
Oh, this is after you knocked down your conservatory.
After I knocked down the conservatory, I've now got to build. Dig a hole, put a new building bit in there. And I had a funny story, which I have to tell you now. So I obviously went...
You'll be the judge of that.
I think our listeners will be the judge of that. By the way, they leave in droves. I was on a flight. Obviously, I sort of chat about the podcast to all the crew. And
good man.
One of the cabin crew was listening to it. And she came out and she goes, that theme tune you've got, that's the Corona song, isn't it? So what? The theme tune isn't that Corona song? I don't want to be Corona.
What's
the theme tune? What? She thinks grown up.
Oh, really?
Corona. She thought it was a lockdown.
Roy, you've got to enunciate better in your singing.
I will do. I wish I'd known. Yeah. Oh, I really wish I'd known. I could have. Could have made a fortune during lockdown.
Yeah. Oh, that'd be another one. Yeah, I never know.
Isn't that great? Well, Jez, have you been up to much? Bit of fencing?
I have. Sorry, I'm just looking through my Vulcan book.
That's all right.
I have been fencing. I've been driving diggers. I've been in Cornwall. Thank you very much. And I've spent a couple of days in the garden at home trying to do some bits and pieces. So, yeah, well, very busy.
Right. You're looking at your Vulcan book because today is our Vulcan special.
Yes.
Have you not been doing your revision?
I am doing additional revision. On top of the not very much I've already done.
Well, yeah, because we need your quick facts, which will be coming up later, as well as, of course, we've got Ask James coming up in a minute. And at the end of the show, our immensely popular Top Landing Gear quiz. So have any questions come in for James?
Well, there were a couple of incidents which have been people have asked me about.
Yes.
There's the BA the pilot who wasn't really a real pilot.
Well, I think he was a pilot, but his hours weren't what he said they were.
No.
And normally to get the job he had, you would need more hours. So I think he'd had the legal licenses, from what I understand.
Is this you being autobiographical and mysterious?
I must say, when I did get my license, because I didn't know that this military conversion at the time was quite easy to do. And this license appeared in the post, and I was like, is that it? I can now fly really big airplanes.
From having flown helicopters.
Having flown helicopters for the last sort of 14 years. And I was like, And the old imposter syndrome does kick in when you get your license.
Really?
So, am I allowed to keep this in the podcast?
But then since then, I've gained a lot of experience, and I'm very, very competent, some might say.
But apparently one of the things that flagged up whether he was really fully qualified and was this headline saying he pressed a button that no qualified pilot would have pressed. What was this button, you imagine?
I also saw that headline, and this has been bugging me for a while. And I was trying to work out what button it was. And the one that immediately sprung to mind was the cabin crew call bell. Because that could get you in trouble, you know, depending on what cabin crew you got in the time. And then so I asked the question on my fleet, and
is there a button that says, do not press this button?
No, because every button has a reason to be pressed at some point.
Right.
It's just when you press the button.
Right.
And so, for example, on the triple, the one I think that most people would say is the RAT extension button. So the RAT is a thing called a ram air turbine.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's a little turbine that pops out into the airflow
when
your engines fail. Yep. When all the engines have failed, you lose your hydraulics and electrics.
Vulcan had one of them.
The Vulcan did have one.
Yeah. Well done.
And so if you deployed the RAT, for example, on the ground, no pilot would ever do that.
Okay.
So that was the one I was thinking. I then did some digging into this story.
Yeah.
And apparently it appears he'd started the APU and he didn't need to start the APU, which is the auxiliary power unit, a little engine in the tail, which keeps all the electrics running when you're on the ground. And rather than turn it off by turning the off button, he pressed the emergency destruct on the or whatever the equivalent on the Embraer, whatever the equivalent, the emergency shutdown button, which then renders it inoperative and the engineers have to come out and fix it.
Right.
So I understand that was the button that he pressed.
And that's how we got found out, because the engineers had
and
to
then
come
the engineers
out.
And then people started asking questions. So why did he press this? And I think there'd been other stuff going on behind the scenes. He'd upset a couple of people, and they said, I'm not sure he is who he says he is. Wow. And
was he a complete fraud?
No, he had a license. He'd flown for other airlines.
Yeah.
But from what I understand, there were things going on behind the scenes that people had upset other people. And he had basically bolstered his hours.
Right.
On this particular
aircraft.
Well, on previous jobs, he said he'd done a lot more flying. Remember, my father used to talk about it in an island he used to operate out of, the Bahamas, when he said a lot of the pilots had what they call Parker P-51 time, which was just time they'd written in with a pen and then never actually flown. and that's what it was, a bit of P-51 time that he'd accumulated, where he'd just written in some hours. Embellish his CV.
And what's happened to this guy?
He's in prison, I think.
Oh, is he?
Yeah. This is the thing about licensing is taken very, very seriously.
Now.
I mean, licensing and jobs now. And if you do, you know, do anything fraudulently with an airline license, you're liable to get
I think we're all quite pleased about that, probably.
Probably, it's probably better that
as a passenger
than the other way.
Yeah.
And the other rather curious story, I think it was an EasyJet flight out of Luton, heading down through Europe.
It was on time.
Happened at all.
Oh dear.
Actually, if anyone's getting hammered for that at the moment, it's BA that seem to be going through well for everything at the moment.
We've had BA centers. Flight cancelled. Our first.
Well, that's happening a lot. Yeah.
Flight cancelled up to Aberdeen, which is annoying.
Yeah, not your flight to LA though.
No.
I think all airlines are struggling with it.
Yeah, that was rammed actually, but it was good.
Mm.
And the airport, it was nice to see the airports busy again. Mm. Obviously now, because we're under the Gatwick flight path right here, because they've opened the Southern Terminal now.
I flew out of Gatwick and it was buzzing. The Southern Terminal was buzzing.
So still have to wear masks. Is that
not
still
in the airport anymore? No.
In the aircraft?
Not in the UK. When you get to LA, then it's all masks.
But the problem is, whatever destination you're going to, if you have to wear masks at that destination, then you have to wear masks for the entire flight there and back.
Oh,
which
really?
Yeah. People are finding quite rightly confusing, I'd say. So you don't know that you need a mask. You get on the airplane, as soon as the door's closed, you supposedly have to put a mask on.
And did you have to wear a mask all the way to LA?
Yeah, all the way.
And then all the way back.
Yeah, and they did, yeah. They're a bit laxer coming back, but on the way out.
That is LA, isn't it?
But on the way there, it
lax
was like...
Lax.
Yeah, sleeping. As long as if you weren't eating, you had to have your mask on.
I'd be right.
But
I eat all the way.
Or sleeping.
I don't sleep. Really. I cannot sleep in an aircraft.
But James, you've told us before about these HEPA filters in aircraft, which means that the air actually is cleaner in an aircraft than almost anywhere else.
Yeah.
So, in fact, doesn't that make the mask redundant, wearing a face? I mean,
some might say that. I couldn't possibly comment.
No. I mean, people question the value of wearing one anyway.
Exactly. You know, we have to... The thing being, you know, obviously it's okay in the UK. If you're in a UK internal flight, you're in the same tube, if you like.
Yeah.
But you're landing in the UK. If you fly to Antigua, you don't need one. If you fly to St. Lucia...
What, on the aircraft?
On the aircraft, you don't, because Antigua are mask-free.
That probably doesn't affect 99.9% of the population.
No, but what I'm saying is...
You aren't flying to Antigua.
It's a great excuse to go.
The problem with the whole enforcing the law is if you fly from London to Antigua, you don't need a mask. If you fly from London to St. Lucia, you do need a mask. You're going almost the same distance in the same aeroplane, but one rules... Whether you're protecting anybody, it's very much down to having to abide by the rules of the...
The destination.
Yeah.
Isn't it peculiar? Yeah. But this flight, I think it was EasyJet, might have been Ryanair, but it's one or the other. Always get them slightly mixed up. And heading over Europe, and one of the pilots dislocated his shoulder. James, you seem to know, the background, do you?
It's the only reason I could see that happening would be in the bunk, to be honest.
Oh, right. But he wouldn't be in the... Oh.
But I don't think they have bunks on
A320s. No.
So I don't know what you'd be doing that would toss your shoulder out that badly. unless he was turning in his seat rapidly to look behind him. Also, I don't know. I still haven't found out how it happened.
You've got to let us know. You've got to find out.
Yeah.
Got to
Isn't
dig
it
deeper,
on Pea Prune?
It probably will be. Yeah. I haven't looked at Pea Prune for a couple of days because I've been busy. Missing my son's birthday.
That's
maybe you should wish him happy birthday. Happy birthday, Godson George.
So send us some questions for James.
Yes.
For the series 4. Anything you like.
Please do. Yeah. But we've always got plenty of our own. Mm-hmm. But we'd love to get yours as well. So shall we move on then? So before we hear a clip of our interview with Martin Withers, let's turn our attention to this episode's central subject, the Avro Vulcan. And who better to give us the rundown on this iconic aircraft than one of its greatest devotees? It's Jez with Jez's Quick Facts.
Well, here we go then. First of the series. They haven't got any shorter. and I haven't practiced these, so let's see how they sound.
Do you usually practice them?
Well, I doesn't like to sound read them through. I have, just to set the scene a bit more, I have brought with me the present that Roy gave us, gave me in the last episode. Which is the little... do we know what this is, James?
Yep.
What is it?
It's a cycles per second meter from the electronic panel of a Vulcan.
Yes. So I've got that just to make myself feel a little bit more Vulcan-y. So I'm going to watch that whilst I'm reading these, which way they won't make any sense.
Good luck, James.
Here we go.
We're behind you.
The Vulcan came into being as a result of Air Ministry Specification B3546, issued in 1947, which in itself is amazing. Its requirement being for an aircraft with the ability to carry a 20,000-pound bomb load at high altitude to a target in the Soviet Union.
Upon receipt of the specification, Avro, technical director Roy Chadwick and chief designer Stuart Davis began design of the Avro 698. The Avro 698 delta-winged strategic bomber flew for the first time on the 30th of August 1952, with the besuited test pilot Rolly Falk alone at the controls. He later, of course, famously barrel-rolled the aircraft at the Farnborough Airshow. A number of scale aircraft, such as the Type 707, were built to test and refine the delta wing design principles before further testing, design tweaks, and engine development led to the first two production aircraft, now named the Vulcan B1, being delivered to the RAF's 23 OCU in late 1956. B2 Vulcans came into service in 1960. Now, the B2 Vulcan featured more powerful Olympus 201, 202 engines and ultimately the 301 power plant, along with a larger wing, improved electrical system, uprated electronic countermeasures, terrain following radar, and the RAM RAT air turbine. Now, the Vulcan was part of the RAF's trio of V-Force nuclear deterrent aircraft during the Cold War, along with the Valiant and Victor. Now, the Vulcan originally carried the American Blue Danube gravity bomb and eventually the Blue Steel rocket-powered nuclear missile. From 1962 onwards, two jets in every RAF bomber base were armed with nuclear weapons and on standby permanently under the principle of Quick Reaction Alert, QRA. Vulcans on QRA were to be airborne within 4 minutes of receiving an alert, as this was identified as the amount of time between warning of a Russian nuclear strike being launched and it arriving in Britain. The Cuban Missile Crisis in October 1962 is thankfully the closest the Vulcan ever came to fulfilling its role as a nuclear bomber. In its role as a conventional bomber, it was able to carry 21 1,000-pound iron bombs. It is something of an irony that it was in this configuration that it carried out its only missions flown in anger when it was used to full effect on Operation Black Buck during the Falklands War in 1982. The Vulcan carried no defensive weapons and relied entirely upon its high altitude to avoid interception, and although its electronic countermeasures were improved over time, it remained vulnerable to air attack. A change to low-level tactics, high-low-high, that's flying out high, dropping down to low level, and then flying high again to make its bomb run, was made in the mid-1960s, but eventually Britain's airborne nuclear deterrent role became obsolete, as the Royal Navy took on the role full-time in 1970 with the Polaris submarines. The Vulcan did retain a tactical nuclear strike role as part of our NATO commitments for a little while longer. Operation Black Buck was really the last hurrah for the Vulcan, and despite its reconnaissance and refueling roles, it reached its final retirement in 1984. Except, as we know, that is not quite the end of the story. Whilst various aircraft were dispersed to museums and collections around the world, two airframes, XL426 and XH558, remained airworthy and formed the Vulcan display fight, which continued until 1992. XH558 was bought in 1993 by C. Walton Limited, who use it for ground-based displays at their Bruntingthorpe Aerodrome until 1999. And then through a combination of public donations and lottery funding, it was restored to airworthy condition by the Vulcan to the Sky Trust, who returned it to flight on the 18th of October 2007. And the donations required to reach that point totaled £6.5 million. It recommenced its display career in 2008, funded by continuing donations to assist the £2 million a year running costs, and made its very last flight, sadly, in October 2015. Its future looks a little uncertain, and plans to rehouse her in a purpose-built facility at Robin Hood Airport look unlikely to proceed. 136 Vulcans were built between 1952 and 1965, and I would love dearly to have seen them all fly.
And well, that was amazing.
Reasonably that quick facts. There's so much. I mean, it was a nightmare trying to decipher or to choose what to put in, because there's so much stuff.
Yeah, I think you got it all in.
Outlying and so more detail.
So Olympus engines.
Olympus engines.
The same as Concorde.
Yes, in fact,
they weren't reheat, so it couldn't go supersonic, could it?
They couldn't. In fact, it became quite unstable at supersonic speeds, the Vulcan, so it was a subsonic aircraft. And at low level, it was also very unstable, which is one of the reasons that doing this high low high for its bombing runs was also, I think they were doubtful that would ever work. I think they did piggyback a reheat Concorde engine when they were testing the Concorde engines onto a Vulcan, and fired it up. I don't think it was actually in the wing stems, but I think it was
underneath the body. I remember seeing it at Farnborough.
I think it was underneath the aircraft. So yeah, that was the same engine. Amazing. Really? What a beautiful thing.
Yeah. And how long after? It was Roy Chadwick, wasn't it, who designed it?
Roy Chadwick was the chief technician at Avro at that time.
Right.
And Stuart Mills was the chief designer.
Oh, okay.
So I think, but there's famously, and you can look this up anywhere, famously there's a sketch of Chadwick's first designs, and it's a prop, you know, it's literally just a sort of scribble.
Yeah.
And it is this sort of delta. Triangle. This is the tin triangle, it's known as it, and it is just a triangle, and lots of sort of little notes, and then out of that, eventually, you know, and the first prototypes were, I think, as I said, were sort of slightly
the Avro 707.
707 was the, were scaled down.
Yeah,
they did also build another one, or they commissioned another one, which never actually built it. I think so. The 707 was the one that first flew with the very straight wings.
Yeah,
but it was scaled down, and that's what. I think was what the one that really fought barrel rolled, and then it was after that they scaled them back up, and to test the delta winging design, and then I think the B1s, I think I may be wrong, B1s had the straighter edge wing, the B2s, the later ones, they're slightly
I think B1s wing. Did as well. I think because I always thought that was the difference. But I think some of the early B1s only had the very straight wing, and then that caused problems at various speeds. So they then had this shaped wing, a bit like you see on Concorde, which I think was also on the later B1s, and you're right, the B2s. But going back to Chadwick, he was the man who designed the Lancaster, of course. I don't think he lived to see the Vulcan fly, sadly.
No.
But the gap between the Lancaster and the Vulcan is really small in terms of isn't it?
The design specification was issued by the Air Ministry for a nuclear deterrent bomber in 1946, so 1 year after the war.
Yeah.
I think that was some design, I think like 101. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then they issued B-35-46 in 1947. That was the Air Ministry specification, and that was sent out to Handley Page, Vickers, and... Avro, and maybe amongst others, I don't know.
Now, do you think they were told they had to all begin with V, or because the first one began with V, the other two had to?
Well, no, that's a good question, because they were the V force I can't remember why, but Vickers and the Valiant were named thus, but the Vulcan wasn't originally called the Vulcan.
Oh.
And is this going to spoil your quiz?
No.
Oh, good. I'd written this down somewhere, actually. They had loads of different names. They were at one point going to call it the Ottawa because Avro had a big presence in Canada.
Right.
And I think the Canadian arm of Avro had a big part to play in the development of the, what's now called the Vulcan. So it wasn't actually called the Vulcan, and I don't think until it was actually first sent out in 1960 or 62.
A bit before that.
Yeah,
late 50s
maybe. Yeah.
When they got the memo, the V memo.
The V memo. Right. And I have got some notes on that somewhere. But yes, so it had various names were put forward before it became the Vulcan.
Yeah, but there's just that the extraordinary gap, tiny gap, a matter of 5 or 6 years between the Lancaster, which what first within 41, 42, whatever. And then the design for the Vulcan by the same man. Yeah, I mean, they couldn't have looked more different, could they?
No, I mean, it's incredible. And then, and I know we're doing an interview around the jet engine and Frank Whittle. So yes, fact all that in.
Yeah,
It is amazing, and you know the two aircraft could not be more different.
The things which I've listened to, I've just listening to a podcast series done by the Vulcan Into the Sky Trust.
Yeah,
there's only four episodes on there. They did it last year, and they interviewed different Vulcan pilots, and they were saying that a Lancaster pilot would definitely be able to recognize the Vulcan and probably fly it. Apart from it's a jet engine, there weren't that two. You know, they weren't
what, from the flight deck. Probably.
Yeah, from the
Isn't
flight
that
deck.
Interesting,
yeah.
Because the Vulcan was supposed to be designed to be flown single seat.
Yes,
And then which is kind of the same as the Lancaster, really.
Yeah,
it's a single pilot, but then the other pilot pops up beside him. And it seems the Vulcan was almost the same.
Almost
it was the same. And then they sort of strapped on another pilot to make it a two-pilot aircraft.
Yeah. And it originally had a wheel, didn't it? I'm not sure what the correct term for that is. Yeah. But that's sort of the figure of eight, which I think was in the early B-1 that Rolly Falk flew and rolled, and he suggested it should be changed for a fighter-type joystick.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I mean, it was a crew of five, wasn't it, in the Vulcan? And seven in a Lancaster, wasn't it, generally speaking? But obviously, no. The Lancaster had no defensive capability, so that was all air electronics officers and navigators
The Lancaster.
Sorry, the Vulcan had no defensive capabilities other than its weaponry.
Exactly, its
air electronics, countermeasures, and things like that. But
yeah,
in the interview I just listened to about the pilot, said you could tell a Vulcan pilot because they had like a crick in their because they were either they had to just turn their head to the side, or if they were
you could tell which was the co-pilot, which was the captain, depending on which way their head was cricked.
Was just clicking their neck over the other side.
I'm asking a stupid question here, which I feel is my job.
Never such a thing.
So, why was the Delta Wing so good, and why do we not use Delta Wings anymore?
So, Delta Wing is at its best on high-speed flight.
Right.
So it doesn't fly very well at slow speed. This is why Concorde used to have to come down with an angle of attack of about 25 degrees.
Yeah.
And they had to have the droop the nose so you could see out.
Yeah.
Delta Wing is great for high-speed flight.
Yeah.
But then when you want to, say, you want to slow down, it's a pain in the backside. Okay.
But actually, we do have to... I mean, the Eurofighter is essentially Delta Wing, isn't it? Although it has these canards. And then the Viggen and... I think it's still.
But you said they're all fighter type things. Yeah, so they're all optimized for high speed.
Yeah.
And again, it's particularly with newer aircraft, the computers make them fly.
Yeah.
At the slower speeds.
Yeah.
Because they don't want to fly.
No. Well, and the Vulcan's design was its inherent strength in the end, wasn't it? Because the Valiant basically fell apart.
Yes, the Valiant's problem was. It was when low-level flight is when it really stresses the aircraft.
From what I understand, both the Valiant and the Victor were not good at low-level flight.
No.
And that was the only way...
Because they weren't designed for that.
No, exactly. They were all designed as high-level bombers. Yeah. Then old Powers got shot out of the sky at 60-odd thousand feet.
Oh, that's right.
And they said, hang on, the Russian missiles go a bit higher than we thought they did.
hence the high-low thing.
The only way we're going to get in is low-level. So then they tried to put all of them down at low level, and the only one that managed with any degree of ability, I understand, was the Vulcan. And the Valiant just shook itself to pieces.
Yeah.
And the Victor had issues. It was okay. I think that as a high-level bomber, from what I understand, the Victor was a better aircraft than the Vulcan, but it couldn't do the high and low bit.
Yeah.
And that's a very brave thing to say in this crowd.
Wow. Oh, that's brilliant. Thanks. Good chat about the Vulcan. Lots of stuff there I didn't know. So let's move on to our guest, who is arguably the Vulcan's most famous pilot, the man who 40 years ago flew Vulcan XM607 on the first Black Buck raid on the airfield at Port Stanley during the Falklands Conflict. It was an incredible undertaking and marked at the time the longest distance bombing raid of all time. I'm talking, of course, about Martin Withers, and here's just a clip of his interview with us.
They could see the airfield ahead, and it all still to this day, it would seem so strange to be coming in, and the fact in a few seconds we were actually going to drop bombs on this
place. The airfield was lit up as in peacetime?
There were lights on. No, it wasn't lit, sort of operating lights because there's no flying going in and out, but there were lights on.
Yeah.
So they weren't blackout. And then... I say just steady, maybe, I can't remember. I think the radar would be talking to me, but sometimes he would put something in and then I wouldn't take it out until he said take it out.
And Martin, you were flying in at about 35 degrees to the straight line of the runway to make sure you're obliquely crossing the road.
We're all on track, because this is the other thing. That's right. It's not just a matter of, we had to be on the attack track, but we managed to achieve that. The craters show the line, really,
yeah.
And the reason for that was the runway is only about 150 feet wide. A Vulcan wingspan is 110 feet.
Gosh.
So it gives you a perspective. If you just try and... I mean, I've still got somewhere at home in a trunk photograph from the sun, which shows craters all the way down the runway. You know, that's wonderful. But you only have to be a, you know, a few feet out, and they all go off down the side of the runway, going at diagonally. Then if it's 150 feet that way, it's you've got a little bit more, about 160 feet. With an angle. So you just got that little bit of extra. And the spacing between the bombs is something like 2 second, let's say 100 feet separation between the bombs. So if you've got two on the runway, it would imply almost that you were leaving a hole in the center, you know, so getting one would have been nearer the center of the runway.
And all the bombs went off okay?
They all dropped off all right. They all dropped off. Yeah. But interesting enough, there are only 16 big craters. The first one, it was the one on the runway.
Yeah.
Wow. So, now, whether that was the first bomb that came off or not, not sure, because the if you're bombing a runway, you're supposed to use very strong casings. You should do a machined casing for these bombs. But because we had no longer got a conventional roll, we got rid of all our bombs at Waddington. They were all, we actually load them up in the Vulcan and threw them off in the down the sea. You know, we did bombing runs when it was no longer had a roll for conventional bombs. So they just were using whatever 1,000-pounders they could get. They didn't differentiate between one that was going to go for a runway or hard target or not.
And who in the crew, Martin, is actually bomb release? Who's actually releasing the bombs? Is it the nav radar?
He doesn't actually press a button as such. This was done automatically in the sense he'd set it all up. To run down to the release point.
Oh, right.
And it then goes off. And the way the bombs are released, actually, is incredible. It's done electrically, but there's a thing called a 90 way. Yeah. There are 90 different ways of dropping 21 bombs.
Gosh.
You can drop them for sort of one off each carrier. Yeah. You can drop one off the front and the back at the same time. You can drop them. And the way they did that, you had a big wooden board. And you had lit things you set actually physically ran up, and if you want them all to go off, you put all the lot to the top, and then they would ripple down in an order to suit. And they were actually falling down and making sending off the message to release those bombs.
Gosh,
incredible! And it was so antiquated.
And what was the forward throw of those? Of those bombs, how far from the runway were you when you released the bomb load at 10,000 feet?
I don't know.
Right.
I don't know.
It's some miles, though.
It equates to, because the bomb just about lands underneath the aircraft, if you're doing 300 knots or something, then the forward throw will be very different from if you're doing 400 knots. It's because, you know, it's the time it takes.
Sure.
But I don't know what figures we're talking about.
No.
Do the physical flying characteristics of the aircraft change as the bombs are going? Do you feel a difference? Does it feel lighter or anything, or is it exactly the same?
Well, because they ripple off evenly, you know, they go front, back, middle, front, back, middle sort of thing. And there are seven on each carrier.
Right.
So we just had three carriers.
Yeah.
It doesn't make a difference.
Are you aware as you're flying that the bombs are going?
I would say no.
Right.
But you're consciously trying to keep it absolutely level. And so you would sort of almost can't feel it.
No. It's not an instrument rating test.
Yeah.
That's extraordinary, isn't it? So you then know all the bombs are gone, and then you turn north and think it's time to get out of there.
just through full power, sort of where I first learned to do aerobatic, not aerobatic, display maneuvers. So yeah. Get the hell out of there.
Was that planned before, or was that once the bombs were on, that was just what you were doing? You were just getting out of there?
Oh, no. Just let's get out of here. Yeah. However, no. And I was just so relieved that I was still alive. This was the other thing, something I can remember.
Yeah.
And this is when I actually got out of my seat and went down the back and had slept for about 4 hours.
Wow.
And so when I was talking to Sir Michael Beetham, the Chief of Air Staff, debriefing him, I said this had done. I'd gone down there back for sleep, and he turned to his group captain aide, I think, said, is the captain allowed to go down the back? The group captain said, in the circumstances, I think it's all right, sir. Carry on with us.
So that was just a clip of Martin Withers' fantastic interview with us. He gave us so much of his time that I think, Roy, we're going to divide up his full interview into two parts, aren't we? Is that right?
Yeah, definitely.
Brilliant. And the first of those will drop in our Full Flaps edition exactly a week after this episode goes to air. So as I always say, depending on when you're listening to this, it may well be there right now. In fact, both parts might be there ready and waiting for you. But do listen. It's fantastic to hear from such a legend. Okay, everybody, you know what's happening now. We're getting towards the end of the programme, and that means the highlight, doesn't it?
Time to go.
Not quite. It's time for the Top Landing Gear Quiz.
It's back.
Which features the Vulcan and the Falklands. So,
sorry, can I just ask a question? Your bell.
Yes, my bell.
It still has the original label on it.
Yes, it
does. Do you intend to take it back to the shop? When
if it doesn't work. Yes, I do.
I often thought that as well.
I just haven't quite got around to taking it off yet. No, so
you're very busy though, aren't you? So
very, very busy compiling quizzes. James, a buzzer for you?
Yes. Well, I went for the obvious. If it's going to be a Vulcan, it has to be the Vulcan howl.
Oh, well done.
So I downloaded something that sounds a little bit like a Vulcan howl.
Good,
let's
hear
it. Like a blue whale and a little bit like Chewbacca, but here we go. That was something from a Vulcan, apparently.
That's quite bizarre. Jez, what about you?
Well, I got something from an interview that suddenly occurred to me that was quite famous at the time. Robin Day and John Knott.
Who was the defence?
Who was the defence secretary at the time, yeah. And it goes something like this.
Why should the public on this issue, as regards the future of the Royal Navy, believe you, a transient, here today and, if I may say so, gone tomorrow?
And then he got up, unclipped his microphone very professionally, and walked out the
and
studio.
Left. Yeah, he wasn't very happy.
Very good. That's your buzzer.
That's my buzzer because yes, that's all I can think.
What
of.
A great buzz, Roy. I hope you come up with something slightly better.
My more buzzer buzzy. Is is going to be sung by me on the evening that the Black Buck operation actually took place.
Yes,
in 1982. Shalimar. We're number 10.
Number 10.
With I Can Make You Feel Vulcan. So, and unfortunately, I can't play I Can Make You Feel Good. So I'll be singing I Can Make You Feel Vulcan.
Do we have to pay you royalties every
No,
time
you don't. No, and because I'm singing it, we don't have to pay Shalimar royalties either. More importantly.
I can't wait to hear this little lot. Good luck, everybody. Are you ready? Stand by
mine's
with you.
Quite good now.
Buzzers? Yeah, it might. Okay, here we go. Question number one. As the Vulcan fleet was rapidly approaching its retirement from RAF service in the early 80s, one country approached the UK to buy them up, or at least some of them. Which country? Yes, James.
India.
Incorrect, but I like what you're thinking.
Why should the public on this issue? As a girl?
Yes, Jez.
Brazil.
Not Brazil. Why do you say that out of interest?
I think it was a South American... Stop. I think it was a South American country.
Do you? Okay. Roy, do you want to step in? No. Name a country in the world?
Pakistan.
Not Pakistan.
God, it's not Malaya, is it?
It wasn't Malaya.
Oh, you guys, you're so cynical, aren't you? I mean, why would it be Malaya?
Malaya.
Do you know where it is?
Malaya.
Argentina.
Oh, it was as well.
Yeah, it was Argentina. They were refused them, by the way, which is probably just as well. Yeah, that's something I hadn't realised, but there we go. Yeah. Okay, no points yet. Question number two. The Black Buck raids were the last and only true combat missions involving the Vulcan, but the first overseas operational detachment for the Vulcan happened 24 years earlier when Vulcan B-1s were sent to a long-running trouble spot. Known as Operation Profiteer, where was this first overseas deployment for the Vulcan? Yes, Jess.
I think it was the Indonesia-Malaya issue, and they were sent to Singapore.
No.
It's not totally wrong, though, is it?
It's not quite right.
That's...
You're saying Singapore, are you? Try a neighbouring country.
Malaya.
Malaya is the correct answer. Well done. It was, in fact, Malaya.
Oh, this is ridiculous. I'm not going to step in.
But you're here today and gone tomorrow, James. And yes. Frankly, no one's going to notice.
They were from 83 Squadron at Waddington. They went to RAAF Butterworth, which is just opposite Penang.
Yes.
And they were there from 1957, October 57, till June 1960, which is almost exactly the same period I was there.
Wow.
So I was there when the Vulcans were there.
Did you see them?
I don't remember seeing them.
I wish people could see the excitement on your face when you said that. Because it really was quite endearing. It was.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Roy. Thank you very much indeed. We've been hearing, we haven't heard it in anger yet, but James has played the Vulcan howl. But what is the Vulcan howl and what creates it? There it is. Yes, Jimbo.
The Vulcan howl, I believe, is created when the engines go above about 92%.
Oh, very good. Yeah.
And it's the basically the air coming out of the tailpipe hitting the back of the aircraft.
You're actually wrong about that. I'm going to give you half a point. Jez thinks he knows it. Oh, for that. Yes, Jez.
It's actually the air entering the engines through the nacelles at the front and how it's drawn through the engine intake.
You're absolutely right. Very good. It's going in through a square intake or an oblong intake and then being forced into a round engine, apparently, is what creates that howl at certain angles of attack and certain speeds, but around 90%. So half of you, Jimbo, Jez gets a full point.
What?
He was absolutely, totally 100% right.
Well, he didn't mention 92%, did he? That's a very important number.
What? 92% that's running wrong.
92% engine thrust limit happens above.
I think already we know that you're wrong.
I think you're pushing it with half a point, to be honest.
Well, I think that's being a bit generous, but he's a dear friend of ours. I read one headline about this, 100 kilos of air being sucked in through square intakes into round engines.
Oh, 92%, obviously. Yeah, that's what it means.
100 kilos. So we know then that the Vulcan was powered by the Rolls-Royce Olympus turbojet, as Jez told us earlier. Which two other aircraft also had the Olympus and are generously offering a point for each? Yes, James.
Concorde.
Concorde for a point.
And I'm going to have a... This is a wild stab in the dark.
Go on.
TSR2.
You're absolutely right, James. Well done. Very, very good. Yeah, the Olympus, well, there were 201s, 301s.
Haven't heard Roy singing yet.
No, I'm looking forward to it. He might get this one. The Vulcan was used as an engine testbed, as we know, for the Concorde engine. It was also used as a testbed for the Rolls-Royce RB199, which was to be used in which aircraft? The public on this issue. Yes, Jez?
A Boeing 707.
No. Yes, James?
Jumbo.
Not the Jumbo. No, you're thinking of the RB211, aren't you?
No, the 199, but I don't know.
The Trent. No. Think smaller. Think faster. Think swingy-wingy. Think of a very fast wind.
Of course it was.
Typhoon.
You've got a buzz. Yep.
Typhoon.
No, that doesn't have swing wings.
I can make you feel...
Yes, right.
Lightning.
Oh, neither does that.
All right.
Tornado.
It is the tornado, but you're too late.
Well, I was buzzing.
Yeah, it was your third gun.
Yeah, it was just...
Carry on naming aircraft until you get one right with the engineer.
At least I named some.
I was letting Roy have a go. The moment he said swing wing, I knew, but I wanted Roy to sing.
Okay, we've had the Vulcan howl. What exactly is the Vulcan death grip? The Vulcan death grip. Why should the public
call this? Yes, Joe. It's what Dr. Spock did in
incorrect. Star Trek. He was an expert on children, Dr. Spock.
Oh, Spock.
Mr. Spock. I mean, any Star Trekkie, non-Star Trekkie will know the difference.
Spock did in Star Trek. It was his grip around the neck.
I'll give you that. Well done. The death grip. There was also the nerve pinch, the Vulcan nerve pinch. Do you know what that is?
No.
That is actually the one on the neck. The death grip is when he grabs your face.
Oh.
But I'm going to give
you one. Are we talking about Star Trek now?
Yeah.
Oh, well, right. Okay, right.
We're
sorry.
Talking about Vulcan.
I thought we veered. Right, okay.
Right, should we get back onto the Vulcan aircraft? I think.
Or we could do a Star Trek podcast and bore everyone to...
Not the Trekkies. Right, next question. Which British bomber type did the Vulcan replace in RAF service? Any ideas? What was the bomber immediately preceding the Vulcan?
Yes, I'm guessing as a Blenheim.
I think it's a point of way. Blenheim. Oh, that's a lovely idea.
The way these replacement programs work, you know, it takes a long while for them to get through.
Yes, Jez.
Is the Canberra?
I'm going to give you half a point, actually, because the Canberra was around.
But was it the Canberra, though?
Well,
I'm going to give you half a point for the wrong answer.
No, it's not a wrong answer, because actually you could.
Well, it didn't replace it,
it
the didn't,
Canberra. It did take on some of the roles that the Canberra subsequently gave
it
up.
It did some of the roles of the Blenheim.
Not immediately before, though.
No, not immediately before.
But it was quite right. Going at the
you've
same
got to listen to the question,
Canberra,
James. You've got to listen to the question. Detail. What was the answer, anyway?
I don't know.
I do not know.
Just sing a song.
No.
Oh, I'm disappointed with you, boys. It was the Avro Lincoln.
The Lincoln.
Yeah, which was the...
Or Canberra, as I like to call it.
The Lincoln was this kind of in between the Lancaster and the Shackleton.
Yeah.
Yeah, there we go. Okay, next question. How many Vulcans actually flew on the Black Buck raids?
Jezebel. I can make you feel.
Oh, hello,
seven Vulcans.
I've actually written you down as Roger.
Seven.
Yeah. It's a good shout, but it's wide of the mark.
Okay.
Yeah. Sorry. Yes, James.
Four.
Four is your answer. Jez, do you want to give your figure? Yes, Jez.
Two.
You idiot. It's three.
I've only read that in the book about 40 times.
Yeah, exactly. This is your specialist subject.
And also, James said four, so you only had to say three. And
yeah,
one.
Yeah. Well, I mean, honestly, if points... there are points that should be deducted.
I was trying to be actually right. So I didn't definitely think about it.
I'll tell you which they were, shall I? XM597 did Black Buck 5 and 6. XM598 was on 1, 2, 5, 6 and 7. XM607, that was Martin Withers' one, did Black Buck 1, obviously, Black Buck 2 and Black Buck 7. Now, XM612, the fourth one, was...
which flew on the mission. It
didn't.
Flew.
It didn't
fly. It took off.
It never took off. The mission was cancelled before takeoff due to bad weather.
No, but it took off as a reserve for Black Buck 3.
No, it didn't. No, Black Buck 3 is correct, but it was due to be the reserve. The mission was cancelled before takeoff, specifically before takeoff. Good try, Jim. No, bad luck. Unlucky.
Definite point. It's as close as a Canberra to the blooming Lincoln.
Well, it's not, is it? Is that one got a point?
I thought that was a pretty good effort. Okay, final question then on the Vulcan. A number of Vulcans were... shall I just give you an up-to-date on the scores, just so you know how close it is?
Oh, sorry.
Yeah? Yes?
Oh, no, it's quite close, isn't it?
Yeah, I can't stop it.
Well, if your name's not Roy Stride, the quiz is quite close. A number of Vulcans were given new roles other than that of a bomber, and I think you mentioned this, Jerry, in your quick facts. In the mid-1970s, 9 Vulcans were adapted for the first of these new roles. And following the Falklands, 6 other Vulcans were adapted for another role which they undertook until, as you said, Jess, 1984. What were these two new roles? Yes, Jess.
Reconnaissance and tanking.
Absolutely right. Maritime radar reconnaissance, MRR, 5 aircraft, further modified, and the K2 tanker for air-to-air refueling. That's 2 points. And that, yes, James, is something you wanted to say?
Point. I mean,
to be honest, if he'd only got half a point, it wouldn't have changed the result, because the scores are in third place with 0 points. Because he knew we weren't going to pay royalties for his singing. That's, I mean, the audience would have loved to have heard that. Bit of Roy Stride solo, unaccompanied.
Unaccompanied.
A cappella.
What?
Whoever he is, I don't know. So Roy, zero. In second place with 2.5, James Kartner, our aviation expert, but in first place with 5.5 points, which must be, I think, one of a record score, possibly, is our Vulcan expert and lover, Jez Curling. Well
thank
done,
you.
Jez.
Thank you, everyone.
Well done.
Thank
I'd you. Like to say that was well deserved.
Yeah, I love.
But you're not going to.
I love the fact that you've left your children sick at home just so you could win.
I've literally
quiz.
Been getting texts from my wife, who's on the way back from the theatre, going,
really?
"You have to get home now."
Right, okay.
Lottie, my daughter is dealing with your her brother's
never find
sick.
Out.
James has abandoned his boy on his 15th birthday. Yeah. I mean,
your,
the things
your
we do for this podcast.
Sick. My house has got no heating.
Yeah.
Oh, my word.
It's just, yeah. You're all right, then, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm fine. Yeah. I'm
I think
fine.
Our listeners should be very thankful how dedicated we are.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. I wonder if they're still listening as ever. At this
can we
stage.
Go now, please?
Yeah, we can go. Listen, thanks all of you here. And everyone who's still listening, thank you very much indeed. And do remember, you can hear our full-length interview with Martin Withers in our full Flaps editions. There'll be two of those. And the first of one, as I say, drops a week after this episode, could well be there right now, depending on when you're listening to this. And if you'd like to listen to any or all of our podcasts so far, you'll find them all on our website, toplandinggear.com. We'll be back in a few weeks with another utterly fascinating account from the Falklands in this 40th anniversary year with Chris Parry, who was the Royal Navy Observer on Humphrey, the legendary Wessex 3, which operated off HMS Antrim, and who fired the first shots of the war. There's also an extraordinary story about how they rescued a group of SAS soldiers in unimaginably extreme weather conditions from the Fortuna Glacier on South Georgia. So that's coming up in a few weeks. And we're also very excited to have secured an interview with no less a person than the son of Sir Frank Whittle, the inventor of the jet engine, to talk about his and his father's extraordinary lives and achievements in aviation. And do, of course, let us know anything or anyone you'd like us to feature, and we'll try and make it happen. Remember, you can get in touch with us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Top Landing Gear. And do please email us with your questions for our expert, James Kartner, info@toplandinggear.com. That's info@toplandinggear.com.
Two G's.
Don't forget the two G's. And however you're listening to us, please recommend us to your friends and family, and do leave a review if you've enjoyed it. In the meantime, thank you very much for listening, and bye for now. This is Top Landing Gear.